All right, very great. We're very great. We're back actually taping. How about that? And we have a lot to say. Started out, had a dream last night, and there was walking in the in like a sort of a dry desert-like atmosphere, a landscape, and I looked in the distance and I said, "Oh my gosh, there's a thunderstorm. This is not good." And then I looked nearer and I saw real close where I was, suddenly there was a thunderstorm coming right close. I said, "Holy cow, this is very." I got this feeling of this tremendous danger. And I looked at, began looking for shelter, and I found this huge tree, gigantic tree. And I began saying, "I can take shelter underneath this tree, get real close to the trunk, the water's not going to hit me." The idea is that this storm is going to, if you get wet, you're going to get hypothermia and you're going to become non-functional. Your mind is not going to function. You won't be very functional at all. This is what the feeling was in the dream. So I thought I could take refuge under this tree. However, as the rain started pouring down, I found that it wasn't sufficient. No matter where I got on this tree, somehow the rain was going to get me. So suddenly, this little table appeared with a granite, like a granite slab with on some steel post that I could that I put it over me, and I was able to keep the rain off of me. I don't know where it came from, but it was there. And I was able to. There were some others that also were desperately seeking refuge with me. I was able to get through the storm and not get soaked by it. But this is a very, very traumatic dream. There is this storm coming in the world. There is this very bad storm coming, ideological storm. We don't know the sum total of it, how bad it's going to be. But if you don't take refuge, you're going to be in a situation where, I don't know if you ever had hypothermia. I have, and you can't function. You seem like you're an idiot. It's like you can't move your body properly. You can't speak properly. You just it's horrible. It's just the most amazing thing. This happened to my uncle. This whole scenario is sort of the reason why it's so meaningful is my uncle, who was a genius, and it was, like I say, the nicest, the most wonderful person I've ever met in the world, went out walking one day in the mountains of the desert, as he did every day, and a thunderstorm came and soaked him, and then it was very cold. A cold wind came up behind the thunderstorm, and he lost all his body heat and got severe hypothermia, and he couldn't talk, he couldn't function. And so, I guess some friends eventually found him in his house. He lived by himself, and they rushed. They said, "Oh my gosh, something! He's had a stroke or something." He was just you can't talk, you can't coordinate your muscles or anything to speak. And they rushed him to the hospital. The doctor diagnosed him as having severe Alzheimer's, and they began dosing with heavy, heavy medication and put him in a lockdown assisted living facility. And the problem was hypothermia, but he couldn't explain it. Nobody would believe him once the doctor diagnosed. It was terrible. He couldn't answer the doctor's questions properly because he had lost all his body heat. And it's been a hellish problem to try and rescue him from that. Never fully recovered, and it's just, so this dream shows walking in the desert, here comes a thunderstorm. It means unexpectedly, you think everything is fine in this world, but it's not. He didn't expect that thunderstorm to come up. There is a severe thunderstorm in this world about ready to strike us, and the effect of that is we're going to lose all our confidence and our spiritual will and momentum and all of that, and we're going to be spiritually inarticulate. We're going to become stupid as a world. But the thing is, you're still fine. There's the thing. I had hypothermia. I went on a hike again in the desert, up high desert, and we went took a wrong direction. We went up into the snow, heavy snow, and then a blizzard, heavy snow came, freezing all night. I lost all my body heat. I couldn't talk. I couldn't function. And so I know what it's like where your mind is still fine, clear, but you cannot express it. You cannot express it at all. So people could say, wow, this person's like a complete, mental case. There's something severely wrong with this person. And you'd be saying, inside, you'd be saying, feeling like, no, I'm fine. I'm perfectly fine. I need to, recover from this hypothermia. But you can't express it properly at all. It's horrible. So this is what's going to come upon the world is you go into this spiritual hypothermia condition. So we're facing spiritual hypothermia from this global terrible thunderstorm. Now, will this include all sorts of physical things? Is it just ideological storm, or is it physical too? Maybe it has all these components. But bottom line, I was able to find refuge from this. Now, what did this huge tree represent to me? Ancient tradition. This tree had been there for thousands of years. This ancient tradition, this planet, wasn't enough. You can, for example, Christianity has been around, and even Judeo-Christianity, and of course it has roots back in Egyptology and etc. But this ancient tradition, which I thought maybe I can, this can protect me, it didn't. It wasn't good enough. It was a little bit surprising. I was like, wow, even this is not enough from this storm. This storm is really quite some severe storm that's coming here. But I did find shelter under this new, it was a modern table. And the granite was black and white. And it's that which actually saved me. I was like taking refuge like under a table. And I remember it was a modern table. It wasn't made of wood. It was like a steel frame with granite top, and the black and white granite top. So what does this represent? It represents for me, A Course in Miracles, modern teaching. Granite top means black and white. Granite means very strong, very adamant, black and white. It's either this way or that way. I mean, it's not fuzzy. It's black and white, cut and dried. This is what protected me and saved me. It wasn't the ancient tradition of Christianity that saved me. So well, I've been saying this all along, is that we cannot rely upon the ancient traditions to save us from this storm. There is no way. It will not. It's not sufficient. Not sufficient. This ideological storm that is going to strike us very soon. I say September is when we are likely to begin to get hit by this storm. And so I said this year, starting June 22nd of this year, all heck is going to break loose on this world. And it certainly has it not? I just read something amazing that Germany is expecting something like 800,000 refugees to pour into their country this year. And they don't have anywhere to put them. Europe is under this horrible crisis of refugees. I really was not aware of that. I try not to follow news, but recently I have been to some extent, because there's in the United States there's a situation with Trump, the Donald Trump, causing massive consternation everywhere. And now, for me, Trump is a form worshiper. He loves form. There's no question about it. He has all these beauty pageants, these huge buildings. He's in love with form. Well, that's not a surprise, because all of us are in love with form. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here in the first place. This is what Jesus tells us. We come here because of our love of form. That is why. But Trump epitomizes. He says, "Hey, let's just go back to the to form worshiping. There's a way to be happy with that." Well, it's not so. But this is upsetting everything, because he's not a member of the Trilateral Commission, for one thing. He's not a part of the New World Order, and he wants to go back to the way things used to be, like in America in the 60s, 70s, 80s, whatever. Back to, he says, make America great again. I mean, let's go back to the template that we've been using. Now, this is contrary to the New World Order, what they want. Only Trump and Rand Paul are not members of the Trilateral Commission. All other candidates are. The Trilateral Commission is part of the New World Order, which is part of the one world bureaucracy, that they're 100% in on that. Trump is upsetting their plans, okay? They don't like this. They're going to do something about it. There's no way in the world they're going to let Donald Trump become president. And the way that Hillary Clinton is absolutely imploding, the way things are going, he's going to be the next president. And I don't see any way that they're going to allow it to happen. They will do anything to stop that. But this doesn't mean that Trump's some savior. No, he's a severe form worshiper. I mean, look at all the women in his life, the beauty pageants. They're all, you know, saying, look at my form. This is the world. Form worshiping is the world. And this is what we need to be safe from. This is what Jesus came to save us from. Now, I told you that Jesus is already back. And I remember when I met him and spoke with him, related with him, we both got down on the ground. Okay, I'm talking together, lying on the ground. So he's giving me the lowdown, the real information. Okay, this is a way of the ream symbolizes that we're really going to get the true lowdown on what's really going on now by getting down on the ground and talking to another like that. He's going to tell us what's really going on, and. So we're just kind of stream of consciousness here and covering a lot of ground. So I think September is going to be severe troubles here. And I'll get the thread will continue here. I'm just a very rough time right now. Very shocking time, and it's because we realize, holy cow, can we take refuge? Where do we take refuge? And again, the lowdown from Jesus is how to take refuge. And I'm very confident that he's giving us the right advice. This practice of zeroing out concepts that I've given out, shared with the world, and it's reinforced. I read in A Course in Miracles last night that he completely reinforced this. I came across an area, it was just amazing. He's just saying you absolutely have to drop all concepts of what you are. You say, I have no idea of the thing that I am. I have no idea what I am. I don't know where I am. I don't know what to do. He says this is the best thing you can possibly say. And this is the one thing the world absolutely fears more than anything else, is to say you have no idea who you are, what you are, where you are, what you're supposed to be doing, like that. Well, yeah, because we're running on concepts of what we are. And no concepts of what we are accurate at all. And this is part of our love of form. We come here to worship form, to love form. So the support that Trump is getting is the people who are, everyone here is form worshipers, but they want to go back to the old style. And the new style is the New World Order. Well, here's what I was going to say. I just found out today, someone I know went to get a blood test today, and they wanted to pay in cash, and they said, "Oh no, I'm sorry, we no longer accept cash for medical tests. You have to pay electronically." I said, "What?" I heard that and it just like sent a chill through me. I said, "Uh-oh. Do you hear what we're saying here? What moves people's needle in this world? Their health. Okay, there's nothing dearer to us than our health, period. If you want to change the world, if you want to mess with people, if you want to control them, health is the issue. It is the issue, which is why people are so furious about, you know, the Affordable Care Act. You cannot walk in and get medical testing and pay with cash. And my doctor is also talking about how they're being pressured into a new system, which she absolutely hates. She said, this is absolutely terrible. And the insurance companies are just dictating to her what she can do. And she still accepts cash, but I believe that soon that's going to be phased out. You cannot pay in cash for your health care anymore. So already medical tests, which are the heart of modern health care, right? you cannot pay cash. So you have to be tied in to the electronic banking system, which is really what credit cards are all about, right? And why is this important? Because then the bureaucracy, if you don't agree with them, they can simply put a hold on your electronic banking system. Very, very easy, right? Touch of a button, and your funds are frozen. And you can't get medical care. You can't get health care. You can't buy at the pharmacy. You can't take care of your health if you're hooked into the medical system. You see what kind of leverage they have over everybody right now? Whereas they don't have that over me, because I don't go to doctors. My doctor, I just accompany someone to that doctor, and others, but I don't actually go in to see her. I say, I'm fine. It doesn't matter. If you said I have this problem, I wouldn't do anything about it anyway. But I don't take any drugs. I don't get any medical tests. I'm not hooked into the medical establishment of the world at all. So they have no leverage over me that way. They say, well, you have to pay. You can't pay with cash. I say, I don't care. It doesn't matter. I don't get tests anyway. But most people, when they hear that, they say, oh my God, you know, I got no choice. I've got to. They've got this leverage over people. And this is extremely significant. Okay. Extremely significant. You cannot pay cash. There was a sign that they said, we posted it since last month or something. We no longer accept cash payments for medical tests. Okay. Just think about that. And of course, I've been sounding the right alarm here, telling you that this is where we're going. We are going into a terrible, terrible situation in terms of our spiritual. We're going to become spiritually inarticulate. Spiritually inarticulate. So I'm trying to keep spiritual articulation alive in the world, but it's not going to last very much longer, that is for sure. People are already virtually spiritually inarticulate because they're too worried about how do I fit in the new world order. Me, I'm not thinking about that. I said I'd rather not even be alive than rather than fit into the new world order. They're going to completely sabotage the sovereignty of all nations. This is what's happening in the United States. The present quote unquote president, who's really just a global operative occupying the White House, whose purpose is to sabotage the sovereignty of the United States. That's his whole purpose, is to sabotage the Constitution, sabotage the sovereignty, flood the nation with third world peoples, you know, anchor babies, people. That's another issue. It's those on the know, and I'm partially in the know about it through various avenues of people who know. There are people from all over the world who are flying into the United States, and pregnant women will come in here and live in a hotel, then get the baby born at a hospital there, and then they have an anchor baby like that. This is happening from wealthy people all over the world doing this. Not just people, you know, sneaking across the border, but flying in and staying in nice hospitals, rich people. You know, flood the U.S., flood and take away the guns. Take what they're after is the sovereignty of this country and the Constitution, et cetera, et cetera. They want to implode the sovereignty of all nations and set up a one world governance with one set of laws for everybody, okay, and one banking system, one currency, which is electronic currency for everybody. You know, one global religion, a belief system for everybody, one education for everybody, and on and on and on and on and on. Now, Trump is saying, no, let's make America great again. In other words, let's restore our sovereignty and make it, you know, restore our civil rights, restore our liberties, restore, get rid of PC, okay, comes from, you know, pharmaceutical culture, is driving everybody into this herd-like mentality, PC mentality. So, pushing back against that. But he himself is a dyed-in-the-wool form worshiper. There's no question about it. Miss Teen, Miss USA, Miss International, Miss Universe, Miss whatever. Okay, and the women around are all, you know, dolled up like Barbie dolls. And this is the old style of form worshiping, and the new style will demand that everybody, that there's no alternative to the New World Order is to say that we have no option but the body, but this world. They're, you know, they want to implode all spiritual teaching. They want to make us spiritually inarticulate. That's their goal. So, you know, we have a choice between Tweedledee and Tweedledum, according to the world. But Jesus says, no, you have another choice. Here's the lowdown on what's really going on. So I'm trying to get the lowdown. If I have any more information, I'll pass it on. But it has not been, you know, it's has not come out exactly, you know, what are we supposed to do? I keep asking, what are we supposed to do? I went back to an old haunt of mine today. Well, the last 10 years I've spent, this has been my lifesaver, like a refuge, a getaway. And I didn't feel anything for it anymore. I realized it's finished. This place is finished for me. So there must be another getaway place, a refuge from this world. This place was my refuge from the world. I could get away. And it was wonderful, it was peaceful, it was beautiful, you know, it's just, but even that changed, and it's not the same anymore, and the Holy Spirit said, okay, you're phasing out of that phase, and you're going into this new phase. Well, where is the sanctuary? Where is the refuge from the hell of this world, the form-worshipping of this world? This is the question. Man, I'm just becoming very aware of it. If you can do that too, is wearing, oh yeah, this is what people are doing. They're worshiping form. There's no question about it. It's so blatant now that it's quite astonishing. It used to be that we tried to put some spin on it, some sort of religious spin on it. But they want to get rid of that too, because there's always a chance that we might, you know, go back to the desert fathers and actually, you know, turn away from form, actually start listening to the Holy Spirit. They don't even want you to use the term Holy Spirit, New World Order. That's out, you know. So they want you, so right now it's just blatant. There's not even any pretense of well, you know, I'm aware that maybe we shouldn't go too far with this. Let's keep this form worshiping in limits here. Let's not let it, you know, let's not go crazy with this. Now it's like, yeah, everybody, let's just go crazy. Go crazy with form worshiping, worshiping a form. And it's just like, you see that on Facebook, it's just unbelievable. The people, I'm just looking at Facebook, I say, you can just tell these people, like, look at me, look at my form. This is, look at my body, look at my form. It's like they're all form worshipers in the whole world. Another interesting fact, I was just digging through a little nugget here. The younger generation, I find them to be very much like the Roman times. I feel we're back in the Roman Empire times. The people that have come into this world seem to me to be very much pagan Roman types. The Roman Empire types. We're sort of like going backwards in history right now. And of course, in Rome, the homosexuality was very much approved of. It was the way of Rome, right? Especially older men and young with younger men, you know, teenagers and such, going all back to Sparta. And I just saw, I'm seeing these Sparta emblems. I just happened to be watching television. I left it on after the baseball game was over or something, or golf. There's some thing like super endurance contest where they're out in nature and going through obstacle courses and doing all this, you know, really intense, going through mud and things. And it was called the Sparta, you know, the Sparta something. Spartans. And they were showing all these motifs of worship. We are Spartans. And they're doing all these chanting. Both men and women equally were into it. And I said, oh my God, you know, this mindset is the same mindset that was in Sparta, which was Greece. The Spartans and the Athenians were the two major provinces of Greece that were always battling one another. Now, the Spartans were notorious. I mean, I think every Spartan had to have a male had to have a young homosexual lover, basically. I mean, it was just, their society was so screwed up. Sparta is just unbelievable. But a lot of people hold them up. They were held up like, this is like the ultimate highest civilization is Sparta. They're total warrior culture. And I was just driving down the freeway and I saw this big sign, Sparta, with a Spartan helmet on it. And you're starting to see these emblems of Spartan emblems and ideology. And then I realized, I look at these people in this television show. I said, my God, their mentality is very much like a Spartan mentality. Not just faking it. I mean, they're totally, I mean, the women are just total Amazons, just animals, you know. And the men, it's just, I said, Is this a spoof? No. This is what's going on. This is what the young people are into. So there's very strong circumstantial evidence that many, many people who, ancient people who were identified with the Roman Empire, have reincarnated at this time. This is why there's just this easy acceptance of homosexuality and gay marriage. It's like they don't even, it's like to them, it's, oh yeah, of course, that's just normal to us. Well, that would have been normal back in the Roman Empire, and even going back called the Greco-Roman Empire, you know, which lasted a long time, didn't it? Who was in battle with the Persian Empire for 1,000 years, actually. Those two empires were fighting, you know, retaking the cities over and over and over and over, back and forth for 1,000 years. And so, in just the way that the Romans were, they were so into the body and just these, and of course the fights of the gladiator, they were very decadent, and the women were very lascivious. Very, very much so. And I'm seeing that same lascivious attitude in women now that was notorious in the Roman Empire. And the men became indulgent and somewhat soft. Remember that they got their legions from the pagans that they conquered, the Gauls and the Goths and the Gauls and the Vandals and the Visigoths and the Britons, etc. Yeah, they pulled in these warrior clans and stocked their legions with these, you know, vigorous fighters, warrior culture stuff. But much of the Roman Empire became very the citizens became very soft, the male citizens, the women very lascivious and extremely decadent. Most of the people at the Colosseum fights where the Christians were fed to the lions and they had gladiators fighting to the death, this is very common. I think there's some, was it Pergamon or one of these Turkish cities, there's a graveyard, gladiator graveyard, huge graveyard where they buried the gladiators that fought in, you know, they had these stages and people would go and they'd have these gladiators fight to the death in front of them. That was their entertainment. Well, you see that now in video games, computer games, etc., of you know, men fighting one another to the death. But it got worse and worse and worse in Rome. Of you know, feeding, they loved to just, you know, send these starving, tortured wild animals into the rink and throw the Christians or whatever slaves and then have them being eaten alive. And they would go, and this is their entertainment. And they it was noticed, the Christians said that the most people going there were these women, Roman citizens, aristocratic women, and they just loved it. You know, bloodlust. They had this terrible bloodlust. And this is what we're going back to. We're going, and another thing, I'm because of this situation, I've been watching television. I actually haven't watched it in years and years and years. We're going to like CNN, Fox News channels, and just looking at the programs and what's going on. See what's going on with this Trump situation is just causing a furor. You know, this is very intense situation here, and I said, wait a minute. Show after show after show after show after show. What I've been saying is happening in the world. I'm seeing the proof of it right now. The new model, as I've been saying, is there's three people generally. Oftentimes it's three. But the woman is always in the center now. Always, and she's the mediatrix. This is what the church in Rome did, is acted as the mediator. The Holy Mother Church of Rome acted as the mediator between Antioch and Alexandria, you know, the conflicts in this, which were central in Christianity as they're sorting out Christology. The Holy Roman Empire acted as this mediator. Well, the woman now is being the mediator. This has been going on for quite some time right now. It's sort of pioneered by Oprah. She's the one who brings the consensus, keeps the peace, you know, all this kind of nonsense. It's now a blitzkrieg. You know, first I said that women are going into the this gynocracy is, well, first it was told to me by someone who was very much into this back in the 1970s. She said, I already know what the blueprint of my life is. I know I'm part of this plan. We're going to take over the media. As a woman, we're going to take over the media, and we're going to rule by using the media and information. We're going to control, and we're going to crush you. We're going to crush the patriarchy. And you know exactly, and this is exactly what's happened. They've gone, and so they're going into, you know, everywhere now after a sporting event, it's always a woman interviewing the warrior, you know, basically hogging the spotlight, because all our spotlight's on the hero. Here's the hero of the game, and here's this lady, goes the cameras on, there she is, you know, say, look at my butt, look at my form, you know. Let's you know, the form worship. Let's make sure that we stay on script here. So, you know, so there's a scripting that's going on, a deep egoic scripting, and they're there to make sure that everything, you know, stays on script. Now, from there, you've gone into women suddenly jumping into all programs of information and news, etc., and now, there, whatever male programs have been in the past, suddenly there's a woman, and she's the mediator, and she's in the middle, always in the middle. You never see her off to the side. She's in between two men. Okay, this is amazing. So, but there's a reason for that, because that this is a symbolic moderator position, and in fact, they are the moderators. When the program starts, you know, they're the one who starts talking. They're in charge of the program. The men are just there to offer their opinions, and she's in control of which one do I ask for. What do you think about this? Okay, what do you think about this? And she goes, well, you know, I don't know, really? And she goes to the man, what do you think about that? She says, I'm not really sure if that's right, too. She says, you know, this is the way you really need to see it. So the men are just kind of there as foils, you know, to disagree with one another, to enhance the prospectus, to enhance the benign, calming, peace-bringing notion of the gynocracy of the female taking over the planet, to bind us to form worshiping, because women historically have been the center, the heart of form worshiping. And you know, you might say it's not Adam made Eve, it's Eve made Adam, you know, just to keep form, keep producing form, and take care of it and work. That's really more like the situation. So you have all these female operatives now controlling the narrative of the planet. So it's a gynocracy, and it's going, so it's a blitzkrieg. Here's another question: when did World War II start? Did it start at the Treaty of Versailles? You know, some say it started right then. Did it start before then? You know, did it go back? Okay, or did it start when? When did it start? Did it when Hitler invaded Austria, Hungary, or did Germany invaded Czechoslovakia? When did its World War II start? Right? Weren't there? I mean, did it start when you know Hitler, the brown shirts, the Knight of the Long Knives, and killed all his generals, purged his party, or the Kristallnacht when they rounded up the Jews and started, you know, the thugs started, you know, killing them, or did when they started passing laws against the Jews, or when the military to build up the huge rallies, did it start then? You know, the war machine, or getting that war machine ready. When did it start? Right, I mean, wasn't it a process, right? Of you could see it, the wise people say, "Hey, wait a minute, look at the ideology, look at the pagan, look at what they're doing." Did it start when the idea of living space, or they passed this law, basically, of the, we have the right to for our Lebensraum, whatever it is, a living space. Germans don't have enough space to live. And of course, there were a lot of Germans in Austria-Hungary and various different places that had gone and lived in those places with communities and farms and everything like that. And they said, "We want to make this one big German Reich, this whole area, see, big area, because we need more space. We don't have space here." Is that when it began? The ideology behind it, the rationale behind it, says this is the reason. This is how we rationalize to ourselves, taking this. These steps to annex, to incorporate all this territory, you know, isn't that when it started? Or when they built up the war machines? When does it start? When does a war start? It's an interesting question. When does a tsunami start? Well, doesn't it start with the earthquake, or does it start with the tension on the earth plates and the shifting of the plates? Or does it start? Does it only start when the tsunami hits the beach? You know, what is a tsunami? Is it just hitting the beach, or is it traveling toward the beach at hundreds of miles an hour? Or whatever? Isn't that is that when, you know, when do you realize there's a war going on? Well, everybody has different parameters about it, don't they? And some people didn't say that World War II started until the Nazis drove into, what, Belgium and the Netherlands and France, and, you know, that's when it started, or, you know, whatever. But, or when you know, Battle of Britain, I don't know. But there's all different types of things. For Americans, it kind of started when we entered the war. You know, the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor. That's when World War II started. That's how we look at it, really, here. Isn't that amazing? You know, so it depends on your perspective. When does something start? And we have, I've said last, I think it was last March 2014, I said World War II has started. It's already, World War III has started. Literally, I call it, you know, officially I said this is the start of World War III. So it's been already raging for over a year now, actually. And, you know, most people still think, well, it hasn't really started yet and everything's fine. Really? Really? What are all these refugees flooding into Europe? Why are they flooding into Europe, you know? I mean, but it's an ideological war more than anything. And it's been ferocious. There's a ferocious ideological war going on right now. I've been reporting on this ferocious ideological war for years. It actually started back in the 70s. If you really want to talk about it, maybe, you know, 1977 or something, you can say started, you know, and the roots go back even deeper, but ultimately all the way back to our own arrogance, trying to be greater than God, which is behind all of this. But we're, you know, there's a moment of truth for each one of us where we suddenly say, uh-oh, you know, there really is a war going on here. Holy cow. And the war is to make us spiritually inarticulate and unable to hear, listen. We don't know how to listen anymore. We don't know how to hear anymore. We don't know how to have the patience. We don't know the full stop and the wow. We don't have the skills to understand our options, the spiritual option, what Jesus has told us. We have this option. The idea is to make our attention span so short that we just can't focus on it at all, and unwilling to focus on it. So there's a war against our mind. It's really a war against our mind to make us spiritually inarticulate. So this storm that I saw coming, I said, oh my gosh, if I get soaked, I'm going to become, have this terrible hypothermia, and I'll be incoherent, unable to be, you know, be a disaster, you know, spiritually inarticulate, you can call it. So I said, I have to take refuge from this. And I was able to, with extreme measures. But a lot of people were not. And I thought, like, why don't we just wear, like, a waterproof suit? And I said, yeah, that's a lot easier, isn't it? That might be, why don't we just be in spirit then, right? Yeah, and not have the trouble with form at all. So this is what people are having trouble with right now. I'm seeing that people are becoming more and more spiritually inarticulate here. There's no question about it. As this ferocious war continues. And we can't pay cash. Pretty soon we won't be able to buy anything with cash. There's new laws in the United States, banking laws, where you cannot take out large sums of cash, nor deposit. You can't have in your possession large sums of cash. You get flagged. This is extraordinary. We need to realize what's going on. There's a war against currency going on in the world. You can't say, well, you know what, I'm going to pull out $40,000. I'm going to buy a little boat or something. And you can't do that, really. You cannot move your cash around. You will be flagged and for some criminal offense, actually. This is how bad it's gotten. It's way worse than we realize. The momentum of it is way worse than we realize. And again, like in World War II, most Americans said, well, that's over there. You know, it's not our concern. Not our concern. It's just some European, another European conflict. They've been having conflict forever, you know. You know, they should be able to work it out. Hitler's a reasonable guy, they think. We still thought, you know, based on our diplomats saying that, and, you know, Neville Chamberlain, except whatever, that's English, but do, who's it, Dewey or whatever, say, yeah, this guy's not so bad, he, you know, you can reason with him, we can make treaties, you know, he just wants a little more space, and that's just some conflict they've been having, and, but it's not a big deal, you know, it's not a global conflict. Well, look what happened. Keep in mind that those who want the New World Order, they want the global conflict. They're the ones who are orchestrating it, actually. Absolutely they are. I mean, where did this ISIS come from? I mean, we funded it. We gave it all its weaponry. I mean, back in, you know, in Iraqi. I mean, these are basically the one people that we, you know, empowered. And they have our machinery and our technology. And it could have been stopped 100 times over. I mean, so many, 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 many options. But no. The purpose is to create a global conflict where break down sovereignty, break down all the structures that we've had, break down the currency, you know, break down the laws, martial law everywhere, and then out of that martial law will be a new formation. United Nations will take, what is it, something like the United Nations just said something about the United States, they don't need our permission or something, something ridiculous. Basically saying we don't your laws don't matter anymore. You know, we'll make a treaty in your name and you don't have any say in it or something. So this is what's happening. This is what's coming here. And the goal is to make us spiritually inarticulate and sophisticated form worshippers, as if the idea of being, you know, sophisticated form worshippers is somehow different than being form worshippers. It's not any different, you know. It's not any different. Now, so, I've been doing a lot of graphics. Like yesterday, I did 285 pictures of Jesus, but it's in, I can't really put it up here. It's in bitmap format. I pulled it off of the video that I did, the beautiful video of the reflecting waters of Jesus, and I have all these stills now where I can do posters, but it takes a lot of work and a lot of time, and nobody's really looking at them anyway. What I find is people become spiritually inarticulate. I mean, I'm still able to relate to them. I'm able to see the depth of it, I'm able to feel it, but I can see how it's easy to miss it. They say, oh, no, it's just, you know, I don't see anything there. We're right on the cusp of spiritual inarticulateness, of spiritual hypothermia. Absolutely. We're right on the cusp of it, and September is going to be the pushed, P-U-T-S-D, how do you say that, German? Pushed. I can't say pushed. German pushed, the big push, the big blitzkrieg. There have been a number of blitzkriegs already, but I feel that September is going to be, the September storm is coming. And this, in this dream, I saw a storm at a distance, as they said, and someone was pointing this out, and they said, whoa, look at that desert storm, look how bad that is. I said, yeah. I said, wow, that is, those poor people really, they hopefully, you know, they were prepared, because that's a nasty thunderstorm there. I can see it. And then I looked and I said, oh, wait a minute. And someone said, hey, what about this storm right here? It looks like there's one right here. And I looked up and there was. I said, holy cow, this is going to clobber us right here. So, you know, I mean, most people think, well, there's a war in the Middle East, you know, in the ancient Mesopotamia, Syrian, you know, area, what's the big deal? Well, Europe is starting to feel the big deal about it, right, with all the refugees pouring in. They don't know, where can Germany put 800,000 refugees in 1 year? I mean, it's they think it's going to become a catastrophe for them. And they're just putting them in tents and gymnasiums, they're running out of space. You know, the German people are not going to like that at all. This is going to cause civil unrest in Germany. And these other European countries. Absolutely it is. And they're trying to get into England through the tunnel, right? England through the tunnel. They're trying to get, they're just desperate. I mean, they're just, you know, they're refugees. They're refugees. And, you know, we've already have, you know, millions and millions of refugees in the United States from the collapse of the, you know, Mexican drug wars and the, you know, the terrible situations in Mexico. The people are just, you know, a lot of are fleeing from Mexico, saying, you know, this, it's a dangerous place. It's a horrible place down there, actually. In many regards, and people from Central America also fleeing, you know, dangerous, violent, terrible conditions. So there's refugees problem all over the world going on right now, and likely to get much, much worse, which is what happens in wars, right? And when you flood the zone, so the idea is break down the sovereignty of all nations, flood the zone with third world peoples, refugees, and say martial law, and you know, collapse. This is what they're all in on. This, they're all in on this. You know, it's utterly ridiculous that they couldn't have stopped this situation in the Middle East if they wanted to, had the will to do so. And now they're exacerbating the whole situation with you know, the Iran deal, et cetera, et cetera. Let me see. I'm getting a little call here. Okay, one moment. I'll have to take this one. Okay, perfect example of distraction going on in this world. Okay, somebody's shopping for me, supposedly, and oh, they forgot their checkbook, they don't have any way to pay for it, so can I, you know, interrupt this and go down? I said, no, you know, no. So, this is happening all the time now, actually, of ridiculous situations arising, trying to interrupt my taping, and what I'm doing is happening more and more and more. Just strategies. This is the ego. The ego strategizes how to make us spiritually inarticulate. That's its goal. Keep in mind that that's all the ego can do. Ultimately, we do have the power to free ourselves from form worshiping, from this dream of death, from this pretense of pretending to be dead. But so the only way to prevent that is to be spiritually inarticulate. And so this is the ego's goal. It is just to bind us to this spiritual inarticulateness, to bind us to this, to make it a legal necessity. Okay. Now, that's why the ego wants a one-world governance thing. It doesn't want us to be able to say, well, there's a land of freedom here. I got free speech, liberties like in the United States. I can say what I want to say. I can think what I want to think. I can express what I want to think. I can disagree with this. I can protest. I can do, you know. The ego doesn't want that, because you might say, hey, I want to meditate. I want to think about, believe this. I want to teach other people this. No. The ego, terrifies the ego. So it wants to, above all else, it wants to collapse the sovereignty of the United States. Any place in this world where there's true, where you're able to truly, you know, express yourself in freedom, it wants to end that. And it wants to institute this global spiritual inarticulateness. So we can't, so that we never really exercise the rights that we actually have, the spiritual rights to. Stop pretending. That's all. Ultimately, it's just a matter of to stop pretending, or as Jesus tells us, just simply pretend that we're eternal life, instead of pretending that we're dead. Pretend that we're eternal life. Pretend that we're not separate from God. Pretend that, and then ultimately from there we can even drop the pretending, all because we realize we don't even need to pretend that we're eternal life. We actually are, but we're not going to drop pretending right away. So, because we're so used to it, we think that's our functioning. We can think, oh, this is how we really function, pretending. And so we won't drop that out of great continuity fear. So what I've seen is there's this spiritual inarticulateness on the planet right now, which is causing me a lot of problems, because my whole thing is to promote spiritual articulateness. My whole life has been this. And unfortunately, I haven't gotten anywhere because I could not stop the storm. You know, so all I can do is say, take refuge from it. You know, I just the spiritual art interest and articulateness of right now compared to the past is it's like night and day. I mean, in the 1960s, 70s, there was so much spiritual articulateness in this world, and ideas were flowing, and yeah, this and people were into it. Now, it's just like people are almost comatose right now. You just can't follow it. The interest drop can't fall. If you can't follow something, your interest drops off. It's not interesting. Oh yeah, there's a, you know, and gone. Your attention is gone, and this is what is taking place right now. So I don't know what to do with myself. I really don't see what my purpose is here anymore, because that's all I am. That's all I'm about is to promote spiritual articulateness, ability to consider and entertain these ideas, spiritual ideas. That's all important. It's all important. Without that, we are just going to be, you know, confirmed body worshippers, form worshippers, valuing our own projections, valuing our own pretense, actually. Imagine how crazy it is that we're valuing what we're pretending to be, valuing that. Can you imagine? This is what we're doing. And we think that if we stop pretending, we'll lose value. It's like I hold my breath, you know, I'm pretending that I can't breathe, and then valuing that, like I really value the state of not being able to breathe and holding my breath. So this is super, super valuable. Well, of course, you think it's valuable, you won't want to stop doing it, right? So this whole thing about valuing form, valuing time, space, process, and form, this is what makes us feel trapped, by valuing it. And so the more a culture values it, the more trapped we feel. Someone else just reported to me, they just went on vacation, came back, and they said they're building hotels. Huge hotels and resort. There's a resort place. Massive, you know, hotels. You know, 40 stories high. Huge everywhere. Hundreds of them. Just everywhere you look. Massive hotels. Well, this is designed to turn the world into this hedonistic resort-like situation place where people simply come and just, you know, bliss, try to bliss out, but just, you know, worship form. Oh, it's so great to be here in the form, the ocean, the this, you know, the this is all form worshiping. Valuing pretense. Valuing our own pretense that somehow we're now form, but we've become bodies, and therefore we think by valuing form, we're valuing ourselves, our new identity of what being dead to what we really are. It's like we're valuing our own death is what we're doing. We're trying to value death. Really? This whole world can be summed up as we're just trying to learn how to value death. Trying to bring out about our own death by valuing it. So, you know, what do I do? I can't seem to do enough. Nothing works. Because the articulateness has now dropped, and people are frightened about their health. This is the real key about the whole situation. As I've talked about, the PC culture is really pharmaceutical culture, and how big pharma and big medical is running the planet. That's the most potent group on this planet. They have the most control by far, because everyone is concerned about the health of their body, and they're seeing that their only option is this modern medicine, pharmaceuticals, and of course any other thing that brought up are quickly co-opted by this whole complex. And that somehow we have, you know, everyone's concerned about their health, their future health. And so this, when anything speaks to that concern, it tends to obliterate spiritual articulateness. If Big Pharma says, hey, stop listening to this spiritual stuff, people will stop listening. This is what I found. Now, see, I still tape. I'm still taping. I haven't stopped taping because they cannot intimidate me. They're trying. I'll tell you that. The people around, everyone say, "Oh my God, you know, I'm sick. I'm got this. I need this. I need drugs. I need this and that." You know, but no, they cannot intimidate. Have not been able to yet. But they have gotten to almost everyone. And this is what we're told about the end times. Even the elect of God will find themselves falling away back into form worshiping and pretense because of concerns about their health. Now, in the past, the people were much more spiritual articulate because and more feisty because they didn't have any health system except religion was their health system. Miracles and saints and relics, I mean, that's what they call the relics from the saints. They'd fight over like a piece of a finger bone from St. Matthew or Mark or whatever. Some churches says we have the finger bone of St. Mark, the Apostle Mark, here in our church. And it's in a reliquary box, you know, on the altar or somewhere near whatever. It's in the church. And people could come from all over. Millions and millions of people would come praying, asking St. Evangelist Mark for healing, for health. And if they weren't sick, they'd say, "Keep me well, keep me well." Because they had a bone. So all over the Christianity, the relics of the saints were spread out all over. So, well, I have the, you know, I have the shoes, the sandal of St. Andrew, and I have a piece of hair from St. Thomas, and, you know, we have the skull of St. Andrew, and I don't know, just on and on and on. You know, I got a piece of the cross that Jesus died on, and it's right here, you know. The shroud, you got the burial shroud of Jesus. These are relics, relics, relics. Christianity is really a religion of relics. And these were actual, this was the placebo of a medical treatment for the people for thousands of years. So, plus they didn't live long. So they're full of the energy of youth. And they say, well, you know, well, of course they obeyed the church because that was the medical establishment back then. But, they needed to be spiritually articulate back then because that's what the medical establishment required of them back then, you see. Interesting. The bones are the most, they last longer, you see. So those are the ones that they really go after. The cloth deteriorates and clothing, you know, but the bones. You gotta get that. We have a femur bone. From Paul. I mean, isn't Peter like buried, St. Peter being buried? I think Paul is also buried in Rome under the, you know, I think over the tomb of St. Peter is mostly the Roman, you know, St. Peter's Cathedral is built over the tomb. They actually have this, you know, this stairway that leads underground there in the church where it is, you know, the tomb of St. Peter's there. So it's like, hey, you come here, you're gonna get healed because they were full of healing miracles. It was the medical establishment. It's always been the medical establishment in this world that calls the shots here, folks. Okay? Always. How could it not be? What is our number one concern? Health of our body. Oh my God, look at all these people, older people getting sick and dying and struggling. Oh my God, I hope that doesn't happen to me. I don't want to get sick and getting all these various troubles and illnesses and sicknesses. The worship of the form then ends up being that we're obsessed with the health of our body and feeling helpless and hopeless. How God, I don't know how to get well. So anyone who's the authority on how we can help you get well from illness, then this is the medical establishment. And this is by far and away the strongest ideological force on the planet. They're calling the shots. Cleverly. I saw this commercial and it starts out, it's doing stuff. I said, I was looking at this weird commercial. And I said, you know what? This has to be for pharmaceuticals. It's got to be. You know, you just tell. Another interruption. just full stop in the wow. Let this percolate here. One moment. There you go, another interruption that's not needed, and it was all contrived, the whole thing, absolutely. I said, oh, well, there really isn't a crisis, you know, it's a contrivance. And we got this noise next door, so I hope you just enjoyed that, you know, all that noise. So the spiritual articulateness, I've been trying to keep the flame alive by just keeping your attention. You need to keep on working on it, working at it, working at it, working at it. It's like a language. It's like a skill. You have to be articulate. Jesus said, I'm back to relate as a friend with you. Who wants to relate? I said, I'll relate because I feel I'm spiritually articulate. I can understand. I can relate. I can relate. See, this is what's important here, is to be spiritually articulate. And the medical establishment wants us to drop that, because really, the competition they have is religion. Okay, pharmaceutical companies, competition, religion. Religion based on miracles, okay, healing miracles, a lot of it, as far as what people really, you know, want. They want to be healed, they don't want to be sick, and there, of course, the Christianity with Pentecost, after Pentecost, all the apostles, the people were there, many people were there, they just went out and were healing. And again, this caused huge conflict, ancient conflict in there, because the already Roman Empire already had set up all sorts of healing centers, which were, you know, huge revenue streams. There was a medical establishment before Christianity, of course. There always is in this world. And this was a new medical establishment where you just directly would just heal, be healed, get up, you're well. And people would just say, wow, you know, you can't blind, now you can see. You know, if you're crippled, now you can walk. And it upset the apple cart. Okay, and this is what caused all the trouble. Just so now, the main competition with the pharmaceutical culture is religion. So they want to get rid of it. They want to, but they won't. They'll institute a new world religion. You know that. So they said, no, you know, we'll give you a better one, and you can, you know, this everybody will agree the same. Of course, you know, they'll make it. They'll sell it. They'll use all the whores of Babylon to sell it, and all the mediatrixes now are controlling the narrative of this planet. We'll say, boys, this is how it's going to go now. Right now, they're bought and paid for. They're bought and paid for. And of course, you know, spokesmodel, that all 90% of the spokespersons now in the U.S. are women, 90% probably, or more. You can go down the road, you know, the commercials, 90% or more, the woman is the one who's controlling the narrative, who's the good, who's wise, who's smart. The man, it represents the old, the outdated, the stupid, the superstitious, the bungling, the failing, the caveman, the guy who needs to be set straight by the woman. 90% or more of commercials, they've been that way for quite some time, it's all... The women are the ones controlling the narrative there, so I call it a gynocracy. There's no question about it. And then on these shows, who is the host? 90% are women are controlling the narrative of the mediatrix now. It goes on and on and on and on and on and on and on. And they're working for a PC culture. They're working for the overall medical establishment of this whole planet, which is an ideology of how to move forward with healthy bodies. And of course, who controls the narrative of healthy bodies for people in the world as far as deep down their psyche? It's the mother, of course. What when the child is sick? When does a child scream for the mother most? When it's sick, when it's hurt, right? You see these young boys out there playing, some guy, you know, they're on riding bikes down on double, someone's on the handlebars, they hit a rock, whoop, you know, flips over, the guy falls on his face, skidding on asphalt, tears his face and his body. What does he do? He goes screaming for his mom, of course. He's not thinking about anything except his mom. And this is children, babies, children, and it stays throughout life. Mom is the symbol of healing, of medical attention, of medical care, of taking care of the body. Okay, so of course, when you have a body culture, or going into a worshiping form body culture, who is going to front this whole thing? It's the women, it's the mother, it's the image of the mother. Okay, saying, I know how to take care of you, don't worry. I'll make sure you get the right medical treatment, don't worry. I'll make sure you get the right drugs. It's so blatant and so obvious, it's incredible we haven't seen it more clearly, right? Because of our spiritual inarticulateness. I mean, it's just amazing as you start waking up, you just see, holy cow, it's right in front of our face the entire time. It's really very simple. When you've got a terrible fever and you've got some, you know, illness and you've got some terrible fever, Mom, I feel so terrible. Mom, what do you have for me to eat? Help, Mom. Don't worry. I'll take care of you here. Let me get you this treatment. Let me bring you to the doctor. Here, take this medicine. She's the one. It's always Mom who is in charge of your basic medical care, is it not? And this is the deep archetypal pattern of this planet. There's no way you can eradicate that, really. Certainly Christianity tried to shift it onto Jesus, okay, on spiritual prayer, on belief and faith, okay, instead of the mother. But that now has been collapsed. Even when they go to shrines now, most of the pilgrimages is for the mother. You know, they use the mother archetype, Mother Mary, Mother this, Mother that. Help me, Mother, you know. It's like, Jesus won't help you, but Mother, you understand. It's like, basically, Dad, he's out working, but Mom, she's home with me. I got this horrible fever. I got the mumps. I got the measles. I got the chicken pox. I got, you know, this. You know, I broke my bone. I'm, you know, got a terrible cold. I got the flu. You know, just a million things, right, can happen. But it's Mom who says, oh, don't worry. I'm here. I'll get your body back to health. Yeah. And so we think Dad said, well, Dad, he's not around. So I think Jesus, where's Jesus? You know, but Mom, she's here, and Mother. So, but people say, well, Jesus, I'm not quite getting enough from Jesus, so I'm going to go back to the Mother, and she's going to give me what I need to be healthy. And of course, Jesus says the body doesn't matter. You know, doesn't matter at all. Not even concerned about the body. And we think, oh, that's terrible, Jesus. How can you be like that? But he does say the body, when you get your mind right and your spiritual articulate, the body will be perfectly healthy. You won't even feel anything. But you won't, you know, you won't care. You won't care one way, you know, you don't care about it, actually. It doesn't matter. It's just a pretense. The same way like we hold our breath. When we start breathing again, do we matter? Do we care about the holding of our breath? Are we concerned? Like, no, it's just because I can breathe. So we're not thinking anymore about, what do I do? What was that terrible state I was in? That was horrible, it was awful. No, I'm just holding my breath, and I can breathe. I don't need to worry about it. It's the same thing with the body. It's like the body's like holding our breath, our spiritual breath. And we start breathing again, and we say, what? I don't need to worry about the body. That's ridiculous. I can raise it again like that if something happens, you know. It's just my imagination. It's just a pretense. Wow. As soon as I came out taping, all this activity started over here. It's unbelievable. The very minute I sat down. Nah, maybe it's leaving right now. Super commotion, huh? Terrible commotion. So there's likely to be terrible commotion in September. Let's be honest. 9/11 started the whole thing, really. I mean, with collapsing the sovereignty. September 11th, right? So I've gotten some various dates in September that the world has been pointing out to me. Somehow the Holy Spirit sends people and they say, you know, wow, September is when it's going to happen. Now, being spiritually articulate is the refuge in a certain way right now. But I don't know if people are too far gone. They may be too far gone because they're too worried about their health. You know, they're too worried about their health. And the meta messages in this world of the pharmaceutical industry is sent through all the media, through all the entertainment, through the social laws, the socialization, the education. They're basically pulling the strings on all of this. And the meta message that they have sent is saying, hey, you know, you don't have much time. You got to change your ideology, and you don't have much time to do it, because pretty soon you won't even be able to buy or sell medicine or anything unless you're with the program here. You got to get with the program. And so deep down psychologically, subconsciously, there's this enormous resistance to being spiritually articulate. You feel that's something you have to drop in order to, for this medicines to be effective for you, you know, and be part of, in the system, you know, to be part of this new world order system. You have to drop the spiritual articulateness as if it's some sort of myth. You know, foolish myth. Now, what I realized was, it's not that I need to drop it, it's I need to augment it. I need to augment it. So in this dream, I was taking refuge under this huge tree, this represented like the Judeo-Christian heritage, which incorporates, you know, a massive amount, including ancient Egyptian teachings also, which really Christianity evolved out of ancient Egyptian teachings. And so I took refuge in under this great tree, and then I realized, hey, this isn't quite good enough. I need a little additional help. And this is where I got the additional help by Jesus' updating. His update, A Course in Miracles, is an extraordinary, extraordinary update, to say the least. I was reading that recently, and I was just going first line of each paragraph, and I was just skipping through the book, and just like, wow, 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 wow. I never tried doing that before. Very potent. You know, we're so used to thinking we need to read the whole sentence and then the next sentence and the paragraph go like this. And we're so locked into that. And I decided, no, I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to, the first sentence, that's all. And you just, not even the whole thing, just boom, that's it. And then go down another one, that's it. And just like that. Just jewels, jewel, 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 jewel. All these jewels, a string of jewels is like, it's just dazzlingly bejeweled with spiritual articulateness. Okay, if you want to be spiritual articulate, I know no better book than A Course in Miracles. Okay, truly, 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 truly. Journey Beyond Words is extraordinary too, but A Course in Miracles still remains the masterpiece of spiritual articulateness. You know, people could say, what about this and what about this? No, I've looked at them all. Course in Miracles, if you want to be truly spiritually articulate, you can't do any better than that. And, you know, you don't have to be locked into it in some linear fashion necessarily. Jesus does recommend going through the lessons one by one and one, because they build momentum from the previous ones. But once you've done that, then you can be a little more freeform, which I certainly am. And so you can just hop here, ding 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 ding. It's just, oh my gosh, this is just amazing. The articulateness of Jesus, spiritual articulateness, is just, you know, you can't beat it. You can't beat it. It's got a depth to it, and just it's just dazzling. And so, maintaining your spiritual articulateness is essential, absolutely essential. Otherwise, you won't be able to recognize the option of freedom for what it really is. You'll be frightened of it. It'll end up, the ego will twist it, and make it'll make you think that you're losing something of value if you become articulate. Basically, your health care is what the ego wants to hold over your head, which is why this, you know, demand for universal health care, et cetera, is so terrible, actually. That's the nail in the coffin, which people for freedom recognize that. That's why the conservatives want to repeal affordable health care, absolutely. So the first thing we'll do on the first day, repeal it. You know, we've got to come up with a better system. Mandatory, you know, mandatory, but just the way it's happening is it's an intimidation factor. If I get sick, I get sick, you know, and I just let it go and release it and let the Holy Spirit, you know, play it out there, whoever wants to play out. Look at the Sargadatta Maharaj, great examples, and Ramana Maharshi, you know. I got throat cancer, so what? The body has throat cancer. I don't have cancer. I'm untouched. I'm perfectly, absolutely immaculately perfect. So what if the body has whatever? It doesn't matter to me in the slightest bit. This is, you see? Oh, you got to have treatment. Oh, yeah. No. Let whatever happens to the body, let whatever made the body take care of the body. You know, I didn't make the body, so to speak. Meaning it's a pretension. They couldn't really say it directly in so many words. It's simply a pretension. So let the pretension pretend to be dead if it wants to. Whether it's alive, pretending to be alive or pretending to be dead makes no difference to me. Dasananda Maya said that, you know, body being alive, body being dead, exactly the same. Exactly the same. It's no difference at all. It's all pretense. Pretense is pretense. This is what Jesus is telling us, you know. It's all pretense. So this is his perspective. This is the perspective of the great sages that we've had throughout history. Now, we're not quite there yet, right? We're not quite there yet. But we need to be articulate about this, or else we will not recognize the option. We'll become frightened of this option. This is what the big pharma wants us to be frightened of our freedom. They want us to be frightened of our freedom. Freedom from sickness. Of course they want us to be frightened of freedom from sickness, because they're making all their profits on our sickness. So they want to scare us away from freedom from illness, freedom from sickness. Ultimate freedom, I simply don't even care. It's all body's just a pretense. It's just an image. It's nothing. It's actually nothing. So what are you? I don't even care. But ultimately, if you don't even care, the body will function perfectly for you, actually. And so they don't want this. That's the last thing they would ever want. So the first thing they want is to make us feel terrified of, you know, freedom from sickness, which means be terrified of spiritual articulateness, which would then is able to recognize this option and see how viable it is and how preferable it is. You know, it's a seeing, oh, this is an option and it's preferable. That's what they're against. And so this whole situation that is happening in the world is termiting our spiritual articulateness very craftily. And this is what I've been trying to point out, and just seeing people that have not, you know, not so many have been able to pick up on it, unfortunately. It is very crafty and very clever about how they go about it. Like termites, you know, you don't see, you know, you look at the surface and you say everything's fine. We just had a house like this. You knock it and the whole wall falls down. It's just dust. It's termites. But you look at it, the surface, oh, it's fine. What do you mean? No trouble here. Nothing to see here. And, you know, tap, 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 poof, crumbles. Right. So this is the world is saying, oh, no, we have no problems. So what are you talking about? It's been termited. It's been termited. Our will, our spiritual will has been termited. But the ego keeps telling us, oh, no, you can at any time, you can choose, you know, you can give this up an instant. It's a lie, because that's appealing to our spiritual pride, because the fact is we have a continuity issue. We get familiar with something. We get familiar with pretending. You're not going to just give it up like that, you see. So it appeals to our spiritual pride, the ego, and saying, oh, you know, you're this powerful spiritual being. It doesn't matter. You can play this game for as long as you want. And then in an instant, just let it go. So there's no danger in you playing this game. Ah, yes, there is. Because familiarity breeds this intense continuity issue where we think, if we don't play this, we won't have any functioning at all. So this is the most clever trick that the ego uses, is appealing to our spiritual pride, which is why we must... If you want to be spiritual articulate, you have to be humble and repent and see this issue, saying, hey, I cannot fall for this trick of the ego. Because the ego always will appeal to our highest notion of saying, well, if you're so spiritually advanced, which you say you are, and the ego say, I agree that you are, well, then why are you worried about playing this game? There's no worry. Why you need to prepare? It says, you don't need to prepare for anything. Why do you need to, like, you know? So the ego says, go ahead and become perfectly spiritually inarticulate. There's no danger to you. You can just drop that in an instant. But it doesn't work that way, because once you become spiritually inarticulate, you see freedom as a threat to your identity and being, and then you won't decide to drop it. So sure, the power of decision is still within us, which is the way we see it has become warped and distorted. So it's a vicious trap that the ego has sprung, which we've really sprung on ourselves, because really the ego is just the voice of our own arrogance, trying to be greater than God and scheming for a way to do this by pretending to be dead, which means God must be dead too, and then saying that means we're greater than God, our will's greater, then therefore we should be able to resurrect ourselves from that spiritual death. So this is the trick, is that you must, you know, the ego, I said, why are you working so hard? You know, if you're really so spiritually advanced as you think you are, you don't have to prepare. Just enjoy, go with the flow of the world and everything. And then if you don't like the way things are going, just decide to drop it all like that. And I said, no. You know, it's not that easy, because I will be misinterpreting, you know, what my option is, the freedom, option of freedom. I'll see it as, you know, annihilation or something. So I won't decide to do that. See, so I said, I've got to prepare. I've got to prepare for this and not rely on this pride, okay? Don't rely on the pride to try to prove anything to the ego. Like, you know, if you prepare, the ego says, ah, that doesn't prove anything. You know, it just means that you're not really spiritually strong, that you had to prepare. I said, no, actually it's a sign of how spiritually strong I am by being able to deceive myself to such a severe extent that I end up having this continuity fear. That just proves how strong I am. That I do need to work on this continuity fear, because of the extraordinary creativity and effort I put into this to warp and distort and make me think that pretense is my function. That just proves how tremendously creative I am. So, of course, by working to evaporate this continuity fear, I'm just honoring my creativity. I'm honoring my spiritual power. See, this is how the repentant looks at the situation, which is why I keep on, you know, practicing and preparing. But here the trouble is that the spiritual articulateness of the world is collapsing. And once it collapses, there's nothing you can say anymore. Jesus says the highest teaching is your example, actually. It tops everything else. Well, that, you know, that has to be true. But you wonder, in a world that's spiritually inarticulate, how can you really give an example to the world? I don't know. I don't think anyone would really understand it or relate to it very well. People here, they think that form worshipping is salvation. So they just don't look at it that way. I had this dream also last night. This woman and her, I think a child, this very aggressive woman, is insisting that I be her guru. She says, no, you're my guru. I need to go, you're my guru. And I was like, whoa. Yeah. And I saw her purpose for that. It had nothing to do with spirituality. It's all based on form worship and her child and wanting her child to have an advantage in the world and all this kind of, it had nothing to do with spirit being a spiritually articulate. And she's like very aggressive and demanding and believing that whatever she wants, she gets. So, who knows what's going to happen? We're coming up, how many days to September? It's like about 12 days to September. Wow. And again, I'd say, 9/11, September, there's reasons. Somehow they use September. If they're going to start a crisis, it's likely to start in September. I know they say, well, the October surprise or something. Well, October follows September. But, we already had the 9/11 September surprise. And I feel there's another one coming. Don't know exactly, what form it could take. But there, these crises, what happens? You turn into the crises, you watch the news. What happens when you watch the news, the television? You become spiritually inarticulate, don't you? Right? And I was already losing some of it by looking at this Trump news. I was already losing some of my spiritual articulateness. Really? Absolutely. You look, I can't believe how stupid people are on television and on the internet. It just, they're morons, spiritual morons. And that's the whole point of it all. And what they have, the woman there saying, look how beautiful being a spiritual moron can make you. Look at this Barbie doll, makeup like a baboon, and designer clothes and jewelry and everything. And look, I can read a teleprompter. Wow, I'm so smart. That's all they're doing, basically. I mean, a lot of them, reading teleprompters, or they have talking points. They say, this is my talking point, so I'm all made up. I look like a beautiful, healthy maiden here, look how being spiritually inarticulate, look how wonderful it is. That's all they're saying. You can call it bimbo culture if you want to call it that. Whatever, gynocracy, bimbo culture, the war against men, it's really a war against religion, which is a war against spiritual articulateness. Much of the spiritual articulateness of the planet has been invested in men because they've done more work in that area. But certainly women also, you'd be surprised, you don't see them as much in the past as they did before, but they also could understand. Certainly, like in the Catholic Church, the women, some of them are very articulate in about everything, but it's more of like a officious kind of articulateness. I know how this house is set up. I know how this house is run. It's like the den mother of Catholicism. There are a lot of den mothers there that think they know exactly how it's all supposed to be run. And heaven help you if you're a man who suggests, well, wait a minute. No, who are you? I'm the mother. I'm the mother. Who are you? It's like it's being run. The church is in its house aspect is run by women, actually. The priests are just women, men in wearing dresses. But anyway, the articulateness, the war against men is to get rid of that spiritual articulateness that men tend to say, hey, I've got some time here. The children aren't bugging me. I can get out of the house and let me start, let me attend this. Let me do this. Let me start thinking about this. Let me read this book. It's like, they can tend towards spiritual articulateness. Very dangerous for the ego, The ego doesn't trust men at all. It doesn't trust women either, but it trusts them more than it trusts men. So the ego will first invest in women when it really wants to control. It says, well, at least we can trust them more than we can trust men. Because look at the history of men, what a renegades. How dare they, turn to this option of spiritual articulateness and be perfectly well and realize the body is nothing, it's all pretense, and escape from the dream of death. How dare they escape from arrogance? You know, how arrogant of them to escape from arrogance. So these videos are just to help you with your spiritual articulateness, okay? This is the ultimate purpose, because if you lose that, you've lost the war. You've lost the war. You've lost the battle, let's put it that way. Big battles going on right now. You don't want to lose this battle. You lose this battle, well, you're going to then go into a cycle of delay. You know, that's a bad thing. Really bad. So we don't want to lose this battle. And we're told that the end times will be so severe that even the most articulate will be in trouble. This is what Jesus told us. The elect of God, meaning the most articulate, the ones who truly can recognize the option. Right, for salvation, even they will be in danger of losing that articulateness, losing the recognition, not being able to see it. And this is so right now. It's absolutely so. I don't even like to take a minute off, you know, from it. But unfortunately, I have to. This, I mean, forced into some little event today. To do so would seem to be to say no to it would seem to be uncivilized. In other words, it's an inarticulate event, an event of inarticulateness. And basically, we're being told that we must, it's compulsory, that we must spend all our time in inarticulate events of inarticulation, inarticulate event situations, that, you know, going to school, watching television, watching movies. These are all designed to make us spiritually inarticulate. That's their purpose. That's their overriding purpose. Yeah, they put dressing on, like a cake, you put icing on the cake, you know, but, you know, it's like putting icing on a sawdust cake, you know, like that. But you see, well, you're learning about this, you're learning about that, but one thing you're never learning about in all this secular humanist society, you're never learning about spiritual articulateness, never. And if you've got all these, you know, seminar posters and callers or everywhere that, you know, say science is the only thing important, religion's a myth, but you guys are completely idiots, you know, fools, you know, you must, you know, in other words, how dare you be spiritually articulate? You know, this is the province of complete morons that need medication. They basically, you're talking about God, you must be off your medication, you know. This is what they say. And part of being spiritually articulate is the humor of it all. It's quite funny. You know, it's so silly. It's so silly, it's funny. The inarticulateness is silly. You know, it's funny. So you can have a good laugh at it, you know. How ridiculous it is. Wow, the sun is starting to swing back towards the south now. And when it's summer, it's right. It doesn't hit me as bad, but right now it is. It's swinging back towards the south. So I'm waiting for the call. Well, you know, what's the next? What's next? I don't know. I don't see it's possible to turn the tide right now. I don't think we have time to do it. In terms of, are we going to have some global awakening of spiritual articulateness? How is that possible with the medical structure that we have on this planet right now? Maybe to walk around healing everybody, or, you know, to give a boost, but the medical establishment would absolutely, like poking a hive of bees, a hive of hornets or yellow jackets. So, as Jesus, you know, is said to have done, is you know, poke that hive. But so still, we don't know. I can't say I know for sure what to do, what's going to happen exactly, but maintaining the spiritual articulateness is super, super important. So if you can just spend, you know, every minute of your day that you can, I try to put as many resources as possible up right now on Facebook, on my blog, on YouTube, I don't know, maybe I'll just upload everything, I can possibly just you know, even if you don't think, well, it's not helping me that much, but at least you're staying in the ballpark, you know. Maybe you're going to get in a hot dog, you know, and a beer, and but you're still in the baseball, you're still in the stadium, you know, and you go, then you can go back to your seat, you know, instead of just leaving. You leave the stadium, you know, how can you get back in? You know, you surrendered your ticket. I guess you get it stamped, but once you leave the environment, quickly you get whisked away. And once you start paying attention to being spiritually inarticulate, the world which is designed for spiritual inarticulateness, the whole design of this time-space process and form is designed to bring about spiritual inarticulateness, spiritual amnesia, okay, spiritual moronity. It's all designed for that. As soon as you let that get a hold of you, you will be quickly whisked away, quickly. So that's why I say every day you have to study, you have to work at it every day. Otherwise, you know, it's like free fall away from it, free fall. So I'm slaving away every minute of every day. I wish I had a better format to deliver all this stuff to you, but I keep posting videos, but they don't have any traction. They're not gaining traction. The view counts are way down. No comments at all, and no response on Facebook, Twitter, or my blog. Nothing. Zero. As in, zero. You know, so that says something, doesn't it? It's like, wow. In the past, if you do something like this, there'd be people saying, hey, great, thanks, this is wonderful, I love it, you know, I'm paying attention to this. Now it's down to zero. And again, I'm saying it's because of the fear about our medical, our health, is the number one fear, that is, we don't realize that this is the trap that we've been led into. And the alarm that just went off is, you're not paying, they're deciding that you can't use cash to pay for medical tests anymore. Very soon you can't pay cash for doctor's visits. You won't be able to pay cash for medical procedures, right? This is where it's heading very rapidly. And this is the real power behind the throne in this world. Okay, this is the real power. I know people, no one's ever brought this up really. I mean, they talk about the Bilderbergs and the Trilateral Commission, the New World Order, the Illuminati, the elites and stuff. But the real power is the medical establishment, is what's the prevailing power and matrix about the health of the body. You know, where is that? What is that? Because where that is, that's where our attention is likely to be, and that's where our belief system is likely to be. And we will do what it tells us to do. And if it says drop the spiritual articulateness, we'll drop it. So you have all these dropouts. You know, this is what I'm seeing. People are dropping out like flies because they're frightened. Not because they can't do it. It's because they're frightened. They say, what are the consequences for my health going to be? Now, some of the people who are doing it are sick, actually, already sick, and they say, what the heck, you know, I'm dying, I'm getting old, I'm going to die soon anyway, I'm sick, to heck with it, I don't care, I'm going to go for spiritual articulateness. So sometimes towards the end of your life, you have this renaissance where you say, hey, I'm a wreck already. You know, what more can they do to me? What the heck? I don't care. If they want to cut off my medication, let them cut it off. If they refuse me, you know, health benefits, they refuse, what the heck, you know? I don't care. And then they start studying becoming spiritually articulate again. They start trying to, you know, recover that. So there is that element, you could say that maybe it's too little too late, but who knows if that gives a momentum, you know. There is a point that sometimes people at old age, they lose the fear of the world and just say, well, I'm going to die in 6 months anyway. Why don't I start studying, you know? Why don't I start studying? And let me get going on this. Well, who knows? Maybe the world is that situation, going to die soon anyway, the way things might be going in the world. Maybe we should just say to heck with it. Maybe I'm just going to not care about what the medical establishment, you know, what the threats are. I'm just going to start regaining it. But so far that hasn't happened. I mean, I'm of value in terms of spiritual articulateness. I know I'm of value. There's no question about it. There's not many that you know are have more spiritual articulateness, for sure. And so by making all this available, I say, hey, you know, if people valued it, they'd be paying attention. But obviously, they don't value it very much at all. So as of yet, they're not going in that direction. Maybe they will soon. Maybe not. I don't know. This is the question, right, in my mind. How do you evaluate the situation right now? It's very difficult to evaluate which way it's going to go. Now, if we thought we were leaving this world, we'd say, the heck with it, I don't care. You know, this would be a trump card, so to speak. Our trump card might be, well, we can go to a different place, you know, so we don't have to kowtow to the medical establishment, pharmaceutical culture, PC culture, because, you know, my future is not in their hands. My destiny is not in their hands at all. So information on that would be helpful. A lot of people who are standing up and fighting are those who believe they're going to be raptured soon, so they don't really care. You know, this is something that, you know, throughout history, people have thought this too, and it just gives them a feeling of like, hey, I'm going to fight the establishment. I don't care what they do to me. I'm going to be raptured soon. And of course, up to this point, it hasn't happened. But it's possible that it will happen soon. That dream I had where everyone, all these crates were packed and all the merchant, everything was packed away in crates, and they said, we're all ready, you know, we're going to move everything upstairs. Everything's going to be moved upstairs in our store. I said, wow, I didn't even know you had an upstairs. He said, oh yeah, we do. I said, oh, that's amazing. You're already. So there may be an ascension. There may be a rapture. There may be a dimensional shift. There may be all this stuff happen. And we escape the clutches of the pharmaceutical industry. And of course, that's like a farmer losing their prize cow or something, man. They're not going to be happy about that, you know, because they want to milk it for everything that's worth. So of course they're going to be upset, and they'll express their disapproval through Big Mother. Big Mother says, you can't do that. You can't leave me out there. You do this. You know, I'm going to cry. You make me so sad. You know, all these crocodile tears that they're going to cry. A bunch of crocodiles is really what they are. So, you know, should we get feisty now? I don't know. You know, we need a spiritual trump in the world, really, don't we? You know, we need a spiritual trump. Somebody just doesn't give a damn. Excuse my French, but just... says, hey, someone who knows, you know, someone who knows that we're going to be raptured and knows we're going to another dwelling place, someone who's absolutely certain of it. So we can just say, hey, you know, we're going, period. You can't stop us. You can't demand spiritual inarticulateness of us. That's going too far. Nobody has the right, no spirit has the right to demand spiritual inarticulateness from spirit, you know, from another spirit, from no one has that right. You know, they think it's some sort of right. No, it's not. It's a whim. It's not a right. It's a whim. It's not a real idea. It's a whim. It's not a creative idea. It's a whim. A whim of nothing, you know. So we do not have to stay here just because the gynocracy starts crying a bunch of crocodile tears and wailing and gnashing their teeth saying, you make me so unhappy, we can never be happy again. Blah, 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 blah. I mean, never can be happy again. If they can drop, they can become spiritually articulate, and then they'll find a way to happiness. And so, you know, what are they crying about? This is helping them, actually. This is, you know, read this into your narrative like, hey, you know, it's just the pharmaceuticals, the vested interests are saying, the ego saying, ah, how dare you? You can't do this. This is diminishing my hold upon you. How awful, how evil, you know. I'm losing, arrogance is losing. How terrible, how arrogant it is to set down arrogance. And we just say, no, that's, you know, that's simply whimsicality that you're trying to put a veneer of rationality upon whimsicality. That's all. About this world, you know, I don't want to say too much about this world because I don't want to praise this world with faint damnation, actually. This system, you know, right? I mean, no matter what you say about this world, it's praising it through faint damnation, really. It's so terrible. The ego's so terrible that, you know, at some point you have to stop even criticizing it because it's never enough. It actually ends up feeling like you're praising it a little bit. I say, well, okay, it's terrible, but not that terrible. You know, it could be worse. No, it's completely terrible, the ego. Completely. You know, just trying to bind you to eternal spiritual inarticulateness and functionality, non-functionality, just remaining terrified of your true functionality, you know, that's terrible. Okay, completely terrible. And even that doesn't get to it, you know. So, I don't know what to say. This practice of zeroing out concepts, zeroing out conditions. Yes, I'm both and neither, free and not free. I am both and neither, absolutely free and absolutely not free. This practice is very potent, and it's probably too potent for most anyone here. but we can at least talk about it and be articulate about it, at least be aware of it and say, hey, yeah, there is this zeroing out of concepts practice. There is this, you know, apex practice, and there is a way to rapidly get free of all the belief and conditions and abide in the condition, free condition. You know, it is possible. Keep working on your spiritual articulateness. It's so important. But it's insidious because of the medical, the way that the medical establishment in all its facets is subtly controlling the narrative. Subtly controlling the narrative. You just see in these pharmaceutical commercials how they present it. Oh God, it's just horrible. I mean, I just want to scream, you know, how they do it. Holy cow. This is what they think of us. Okay, you look at the pharmaceutical commercials, which are ubiquitous now. This is what they think of us. This is how they want us to be. You know, these like disembodied, robotic, vacuous, smiling. I'm so happy now. You know, I'm taking this medication. I'm petting my puppy here, and I'm at a park. And my God, you know, I mean, just the way they present human. You know, present. Right? It should shock you. It should stun you. It should say, whoa, you know, this cannot stand. I have got to get free of this. So, you know, where have all the flowers gone? There's a song, Peel Palm Mary, where have all the flowers gone? Long time standing. Yeah, where have all the flowers gone? Long time ago. Yeah, where has all the spiritual articulateness gone in the world? We don't understand. This is a true extinction problem we have. We keep thinking it's about some, you know, moth somewhere. This is becoming extinct. And how terrible this is that this moth, that, you know, the Siberian moth in this one little area is like about a couple miles radius. We have some like this. There's some golf course there that it's completely, you know, shut off. You can't go out, wander off the fairway. Any, you know, $10,000 fine. There's some like little, you know, insect there or something that, you know, it only occurs in this area, but it's a danger of extinction. So, you know, so we're so worried about that, and yet we're paying no attention whatsoever to the extinction of our spiritual articulateness. Okay. Absolutely stunning, isn't it? So maybe something can be done. I don't know. I just have to keep working on it myself. Maybe I can help out. I hope so. As of yet, I don't know, you know, what more I can do. I want to do more. And see if there's some way that I can understand that people just want to revive themselves. You know, I keep thinking there's all these people in the world who are very, very advanced and stuff, but there isn't. You know, I'm not seeing that anymore. Most people are like, you know, almost asphyxiated, actually. Or they're clinging to the fragment of it, you know, and just like, my God, my grip is slipping, you know, and it's like, wow. It's Armageddon, you know. The Armageddon is really against spiritual articulateness. And of course, then you get from both sides, because you get the old traditional people who are not articulate enough. And they think, that's all you need, that's all you need. Where that dream showed me, it is not all you need. This terrible storm that's hitting us is not sufficient. The old amount of articulateness we had, it's not sufficient. Otherwise, Jesus wouldn't have returned and given us this upgrade. Okay. But they cling to their old articulations. They know that's plenty. It's plenty good enough. And meanwhile, you know, the world is crumbling around them. And so you get it from them too. They say, "What do you mean? We know everything we need to know." You know, we and they get into all this legalism and, you know, history and stuff, and try to intimidate you with that. Which is why I've been studying all this stuff, so I'm not so intimidated by it. As if that's articulation. You know, I mean, it's kind of like regurgitate. It's like a dog returning to their vomit. You know, fool returns to their folly. You know, lukewarm articulateness regurgitated endlessly is not sufficient. It's not sufficient. Jesus tells us not sufficient. That's what he told me. I said, wow, really? I mean, we need more? He said, yeah, you're not up to speed yet. You don't know what's coming upon this world. It's very terrible. You need to be very articulate. And I said, wow, I mean, I got to work at this? He says, yeah. I said, wow, I don't know. I got a life to live. And he says, well, actually, your life is all planned out so you'll be able to do this. And it just turned out to be true. Because I've not been able to do anything else. You know, no matter whenever I try to do something else, you know, the plug is pulled. The roadblocks are up there. The angels aren't letting me do it, you know. So this is what's happened. So I happen to be still spiritually articulate, the rarest of the rare species on this planet, as a matter of fact. More rare than the white, you know, the white leopard or whatever, the white lions or whatever. This is the true rarity, is someone who's very extremely spiritually articulate. Has the big picture, the whole overview, the whole situation, you know, just aware of all of this. You know, that's not just some, you know, Protestant exegetical minister, you know, hammering away at, you know, Numbers or Deuteronomy or, you know, this, and just going over and over all this detailed legalistic details and adding up numbers and crunching all these numbers. And Daniel said this, and this represents this. And they, you know, they write a book, and, you know, a million books on Revelation and stuff, and regurgitate. No, this kind of articulateness has the whole context of everything in its sights. This is all a complete pretense, what we're doing. We're trying to pretend. We're pretending to be dead. We made time, space, process, form. We imagine it all, the universe, this world, you know, our perception, impermanence, you know, everything is all our creativity to try and be authentically dead and defeat God. And therefore, God has to be dead too, since we're one with God. We're the ones who being arrogant and designing the ego and all the defenses and all of this, and how it all, you know, the continuity fear, the big picture. Spiritual articulateness is big picture. It's not losing sight of the forest because of all the trees. You get so many of these people that are, you know, obsessed with the trees, counting how many trees in this area. Well, if I divide the number of trees by this and add this and subtract this and do this and this and this. But that's not, you know, that's not enough spiritual articulateness to handle the situation. You have to ultimately get to this, the non-dual, this practice of canceling out all conditions, which are concepts. I'm neither this, I'm both this and that, and neither this and that. I'm concurrently, simultaneously, both and neither, eternal life and not eternal life. Jesus says, when you completely purge yourself of all concepts, all beliefs, of conditions, etc., when you purge yourself of all of it, the good and the bad, he says, the good and the bad, both, then you said your mirror will be clean and the absolute, clear, perfect, clear, crisp truth will be reflected within you of your true identity, of your true beingness. But only when you purge yourself of all this, of all these concepts of both good and bad. I'm a good person. I'm an enlightened person. I'm an eternal person. I am this. I am that. You have to purge yourself of that too. So this practice of canceling those out is really the highest practice. And so I don't see, you know, these people who are grinding their gears over all this numerology and this, you know, it's spiritual, you know, Christian articulateness to a certain degree. I don't see them getting to that. Which means they don't have enough articulateness. I'm not criticizing the efforts they've made. I'm just saying it's not enough. So this is what needs to be understood. Those efforts are to be respected. There's no question I respect those efforts. A lifetime of examining and looking at it. But it's not enough. So not enough is not enough. It's not enough. It's not good enough. So that's just a pragmatic, practical issue here. Have to do better than that. It's like the blind man in the tent with the elephant, and each one's got to grab a hold of a different part of the elephant. They insist what they're holding. That's what it is. The one's got the hold of the tail, says there's a snake in here. The other's got a hold of the ear. No, it's a big, big leaf. Another grabs the leg and says there's a big tree here. Someone hits the side of the elephant and says there's a big wall here. Someone grabs the tusk and they say something else, you know, and the trunk, you know, there's a huge snake in here, you know. So they got a hold of a part of it, and they just regurgitate, and they don't see the, you know, oh, it's an elephant. My gosh, I never could have thought of such a creature. You know, they've never seen such a creature. That's the idea. They don't never seen an elephant, so they go in a tent. They're supposed to say what's in here, and they have no idea what's in here. So they think, you know, they get a hold of something. They think that must be a snake. Get a hold of the trunk, and when they see the elephant, they say, "Holy cow! I never could have imagined such a creature." You know. So of course it's what you got to do is you got to say, okay, wait a minute, maybe this ear, this leaf, is there any more to it? Let me go check a little more. Oh, there's a wall. Here's a leaf and a wall, and there's a tree, and there's a tail, like a rat or something, and there's a trunk. It's a snake, and it's but how could it be all these? A leaf, a snake, a rat, a tree, a wall. I mean, that doesn't make any sense, does it? And then so you have to kind of think, wait a minute, what? And then try to start seeing what kind of form could this be, what is it, maybe, and then maybe a flash intuition will say, maybe it's actually just one thing here and not many, and these qualities are somehow just characteristics of this one thing, you know. And so gradually you get a clearer picture of what might be there, even though you're not sure what it is, so that when the light is turned on, you say, oh okay, I had it pretty close, you know. It's not quite what I envisioned, but it's close enough. So the continuity fear is resolved because you get, at least you have a pretty good idea of what to expect when the light turns on. And when you turn the light on, you know, oh, wow, what is that? We'll call it an elephant. An elephant, wow, look at this creature. It's a pretty amazing creature, huh? My gosh. So this is the discipline, is to be humble enough to say, maybe I don't have the full picture. I need to keep looking, instead of just, you know, regurgitating some little facet of it. And you can test out, if you can't do this canceling out practice, that means you still have work to do. You still have too much continuity fear. So I don't want the light to turn on yet. I still don't have a clear enough idea of what's going on. Good way to test out. Whatever good you could think of, I am both and neither. I am simultaneously both and neither. Total perfection and not total perfection. I am simultaneously both and neither. Eternal life and not eternal life. I am simultaneously both and neither truth and not truth. I am simultaneously both and neither happy and not happy. You know, whatever. See, this practice here really purges us, and this cleans the mirror. And so if we're afraid of what we're going to see in the mirror, we're going to be afraid of doing this and get backlash. And of course we're going to get backlash. I've gotten backlash from doing this. Absolutely. It's so intense. It's just like, it's quite frightening. Say, holy cow, what am I going to see in the mirror here? Pretty soon, by doing this practice, I'm going to see what I really am. Oh, wow, you know, I don't know what I am. But you can say, yeah, I don't have any idea what I am. I have no idea what I am, what kind of thing I am. I don't know. I have no idea what I need to do. I have no idea where I am, and I have no idea of any of this. But say this in a positive, like this is a great thing, wonderful. I have no idea what kind of thing I really am. I don't know where I am. I don't know. I have no idea what I need, what to do. Positive, 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 positive. Do this as a practice. And if you can't practice it, at least be aware of it and be interested in it. Problem is when people are trying to practice spiritual articulateness, a lot of them are trying to just get approval for fixation. They say, this is where I'm at, this should be enough. And they battle with you. You know, it's like, no, this fixation, I shouldn't have to go any farther. This is all I need. This is all I need. You know, there's that struggle. So there has to be this mood of repentance saying, you know what? I do need to do more. I do need to recognize more. I do need to keep on working at it. So let's not argue or battle over it. Let me just quiet and listen and let me get used to what's being said. That's the first step, isn't it? Just listen, get used to it and hear it and beware of the wow. Be aware of the wow, and when it comes up, just take a little break and be patient. Be patient with yourself. Doesn't mean you're failing. It means you're succeeding. The wow means you're succeeding. It means your spiritual articulateness has been increased. So this is what's all important. Keep increasing it. And I mean true articulateness, meaning true ability to accept, to hear. You know, being a spiritual expert means how to listen, how to be quiet, how to be still, how to hear, how to accept. You know, this is being spiritual. This is part of spiritual articulateness. It's not just, I'm not meaning just the words, but you have an overall spiritual facility, capability, competency. Be very spiritually competent. And I'd like to increase my competence. You know, I need to do that. And I'm always looking for something to help out. I feel like I need something significantly better right now to you know, up my own competence. And this is how it works. The more we become spiritually competent, articulate, you know, the better able we are to help others. You know, it's a positive win-win thing. Whenever anyone can make an advancement, you know, it helps everyone. So that's why I call upon the great saviors. You know, meaning the ones who are super competent, super articulate. Help us out. Help us out. Help us out now. I mean, what are you waiting for? Help us out. I keep saying, what are you waiting for? Good Lord. It's going to be too late soon. So help us out in more and more direct ways, actually. You know, what's the point in holding back at this point? You know, might as well go for it. So we will see what can happen. And just keep the prayers coming and just keep, you know, focusing on, yeah, let's go bigger. Let's go really big. Always say, today I got to go big today. I really got to go big, and I've got to go bigger than yesterday. I got to go even bigger. So I'm going to try to go figure out a way. How do I go even bigger today than yesterday? And, you know, and it's keep topping yourself. And yeah, yesterday I was able to pull all these graphics. And it was just extraordinary. Some of them was just so beautiful and extraordinary. I don't even know what to say about them. I've never seen anything graphically like it. You know, it's just holy cow. And so how do I top that, you know, today? Well, ask the Holy Spirit to outdo itself every day. Remember, when it helps you, it's helping everyone. That's a fact. When you increase your spiritual articulateness, you're helping everyone. So it's not a selfish thing at all. Absolutely not. Because you become a valuable resource. You know. So pray that the Holy Spirit outdoes itself on your behalf and on the behalf of everyone. Every single day. Every single day. And so I pray for this. Somehow, miraculously, the Holy Spirit will outdo itself. And I don't know what that can be, because I'm in rarefied territory now. And I, you know, have to keep praying for it. And has to happen. So just take the same attitude. You know, don't lose your faith. Hang in there. Keep your spiritual articulateness. Keep spending time on it. It doesn't happen if you don't spend the time on it. If you don't really apply yourself to it, it won't happen. the world will whisk you away into inarticulateness, and then you won't even remember what you used to know. You'll forget it. You'll become amnesia. You'll have spiritual amnesia. You don't want spiritual amnesia, right? You deserve better than that. We all do. So pray, Holy Spirit, I pray that that you outdo yourself, you top yourself on my behalf, and therefore on the behalf of everyone, this very day and every single day. And I expect nothing less than that. Absolutely expect nothing less than that. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Okay, so that's reached 2 hours. That's plenty. I got to get work on it and let this happen. This video is a part of it, right? But we'll see what we expect. We accept and expect. Greater and greater and greater and greater articulateness. Absolutely. Okay. Very great. That's it for this one.